Sir, it is 6 o'clock. Can we start, sir?
Yes, please. Yes.
Good evening. Warm welcome to all of you to the webinar series hosted by Advocates Association Bengaluru. We have with us today Senior Advocate and present Advocate General, Mr. Prabhuling K. Nawadgi. Sir, we are truly honored to have you with us today. Welcome to the webinar.
Thank you.
Now, I take the privilege of introducing the speaker. Mr. Nawadgi is an alumni of University Law College, Bangalore, from which he obtained his law degree. He topped the university by securing first rank in 5 years law examination. He has vast expertise on constitutional law, particularly in formation of elective governments and local self-bodies. He has handled cases pertaining to international taxation, double taxation, money laundering law, cyber law, etc. He is a pioneer of infrastructure laws in the country, particularly in electricity field in the post-liberation period. He is designated as a senior advocate by the High Court of Karnataka in the year 2014, before which he was appointed as the additional advocate general of state of Karnataka. So Nawadgi was the standing counsel for the Karnataka State Waqf Board for a continuous period of 12 years. He is a member of the renowned KLE Society. He is also a member of the International Commission of Jurists, Karnataka chapter. He has advised several sports bodies such as Karnataka State Cricket Association. So Nawadgi has also served as the additional Solicitor General of India. He has addressed various lectures in several legal institutions. He was invited to the University of Salford, United Kingdom, where he had delivered a lecture on comparative constitutional law. He's also delivered his lecture organized by British Council of India. Sir, once again, on behalf of Advocates Association Bangalore, I extend a warm welcome to you. Over to you, sir.
Thank you so much. Good evening to each one of you. Am I audible, Trivikram? Can you hear me clearly?
Yes, sir. We are able to hear you.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. I am extremely happy to be in the midst of all of you this evening. At the outset, I must compliment the Advocates Association for having organized these series of webinars. These webinars not only enrich the audience and the viewers, but they are also very thought-provoking. Quite frankly, I was initially a little reluctant to speak on any law subject, for which, because I have always believed that to deliver any lecture on subject of law, you have to master it, and I consider myself to be a student of law. But I could not refuse the kind, affectionate, and very warm invitation rendered by the President, Mr. Ranganath. Therefore, I am here. I have noticed that the predecessors who have addressed all of you have spoken on different subjects of law and have spoken quite authoritatively. Therefore, I thought I must share not law, but life in law. Because I have always believed that this great legal profession and the institution of judiciary has strengthened itself over the period of years, not by themselves, but by because of men and women who have breathed their life into these things. We have had some of the most eminent judges of the Supreme Court, various high courts, who have added glory to the institution of judiciary. Similarly, insofar as our profession is concerned, we have had doyens of the bar who have led their inedible mark and a true inspiration to all the lawyers to come. Personally, for me, one of the shining stars in this cosmos of our legal profession has been Mr. Nani Palkiwala. I've always fancied him right from my student days, and as I practiced about and have been some sort of an enchanting personality, the way he led the profession in the years he lived. So I thought it fit that we will use this opportunity, take this occasion to speak to all of you about Nani Palkiwala. I must also add a disclaimer that this address of mine, this discourse of mine, is predominantly towards the younger members of the bar who truly are the future. Most of the seniors have now settled down, and the future now belongs to the younger members of the bar, and they must therefore know about these legends, particularly someone like Nani Palkiwala, and draw inspiration from him and his life to lead their lives ahead in the legal profession. But anyone who ventures to speak about Palkiwala, I must say, will face two challenges. The first challenge is, there is already so much written about him. Most of you know about it. So what is that you should speak which you don't know is the first challenge any speaker will face. The second challenge is, there is so much to be spoken about him. His life has had so many facets. So how do you concise it in a short span of 1 hour or 45 minutes, etc.? Notwithstanding these two challenges, I have thought it fit to share few of his life moments, few of his achievements in the legal profession, which possibly would be some amount of inspiration to each one of you. Nani Palkiwala, you must all know, was a multifaceted personality. He was just not an outstanding lawyer, but he was a great economist. He was a great humanist. He was a great defender of constitutional liberties. And more than anything else, he was one of the outstanding constitutional experts this country ever saw. Therefore, before I address, let us divide how his life has be a, how to graph his life in three possible phases. One is, what made Palkiwala a great lawyer? The making of a great lawyer of Palkiwala. The second phase could be, what was his contribution towards the evolution of our constitutional jurisprudence? And lastly, as the topic indicates, Nani Palkiwala, his life, his times, and why he was an icon. So let us start, let us begin from the beginning itself. Nani Adarsh Palkiwala, as he was known, was born in the year 1920 to a middle-class Parsi couple. Namely, his mother was Sahira Bano. His father was, as name indicates, Adarsh Palkiwala. He was named after his grandfather, Nana Bhai. He underwent his higher education in Mumbai and completed his law graduation in the Government Law College, very famous Government Law College, Mumbai. And he entered the very famous Mumbai bar. I would pause here for a moment and slightly digress for you, all of you to know why I said the famous Mumbai bar. Mumbai bar, as we all know, as one of the original chartered high courts, has the greatest tradition of legal profession. When Mr. Palkiwala entered the profession, he joined the office of Sir Jamshedji Kanga. Now, I must say something about Sir Jamshedji Kanga. Sir Jamshedji Kanga himself was a doyen at the bar, and his office, Kanga and Company, still is there in Mumbai. And when Mr. Palkiwala entered the profession, it was just not Kanga. There were several other leading personalities in the legal profession, like Motilal Sethlwat, the first Attorney General of India, C.K. Daftari, the first Solicitor General of India, who went on to become the Attorney General of India, Bholabhai Desai, Sir John Duncan Inverarity, another doyen in the profession, and of course, including Mr. Muhammad Ali Jinnah. There were Justice Chagla was the, at that time, a judge of the Mumbai High Court. It was in this background, it was in this scenario, Mr. Palkiwala entered the profession along in the very famous chambers of Sri Jamshedji Kanga. I was speaking of what made Mr. Palkiwala a very outstanding, making of a great lawyer. Two qualities of his we should never forget. He had an almost photographic memory and an amazing quality of recalling possibly everything he had read or perceived. And secondly was about his oratorial skills, which possibly are two great armaments in any lawyer's you can say Amri. Now, as soon as he entered the profession, he immediately, possibly at the age of 29 or 30, he was regarded as one of an outstanding lawyer. He was engaged by so many law firms in Mumbai, and particularly in the subjects of constitutional law and taxation. And one of the first arguments he advanced, which is reported, was in the case of F.N. Balsara versus State of Maharashtra, which is a judgment reported in AIR 1951, Mumbai page 210, wherein the Bombay Prohibition Act was challenged. Now, we are talking in 1951. Today, the constitutional law has really evolved and developed itself. It was at that time he first principally argued that the Mumbai Prohibition Act, which was legislated by the Mumbai province legislature under the Medicinal and Toilet Preparation Act, was beyond the legislative competence. That is, he went to entries, argued on doctrine of pith and substance. The second ground on which he argued that matter was that the prohibition of abkari was violative of Article 19, and on both grounds they succeeded. I specifically mentioned these two judgments because you will see later on, somewhere in 1970, when Mr. Palkiwala argues the very famous bank nationalization case, he relies upon this 51 judgment, first of itself. So you could see such fundamental principles, clarity of thinking, he could argue at a very, very early age. Two things they have observed about Palkiwala, what made him to be a great lawyer initially. One was his clarity of thinking. He always believed that the role of a lawyer is just not to represent his client or to convert black into white or white into black, but to assist the judge to come to the right conclusion. This was his first quality. Second quality is, whenever he argued any case, he used the least of the simplest words. Let us say one word carries about seven meanings, and as per the thesaurus, he used to use the simplest word, which would make the judges, the task of the judges, very easy. Now, I was talking of his memory, how he could recall anything, almost photographic memory. This I will illustrate by one or two examples. One of the examples which we could give was, he along with Kanga, and practically Kanga, they say, only led his name, but has written what is considered as a Leviathan, a masterly piece on income tax law, known as the practice of income tax in India by Kanga and Palkiwala. Most of the lawyers who are practicing in the tax side will know that it is considered the Bible for all income tax practitioners. The book runs for more than 500 to 600 pages. There is a reason why I'm mentioning this. The book became very popular across the country. Everyone started referring that. Somewhere at the same time, one very senior and eminent advocate, Sampath Iyengar from the Madras Bar, also had written a book on income tax law. Now, he felt this Kanga and Palkiwala had picked up the contents of his book, had copied it. Therefore, they had violated the Copyright Act, and therefore he filed a suit in Madras High Court, making Palkiwala as defendant number two and Kanga as defendant number one, saying that there is a violation of the Copyright Act, they must be sued. And Mr. Palkiwala is actually drawn to witness box as defendant number two to justify that this was not actually an act of copyright, violation of copyright. It is stated, and I have read the judge's observation during that cross-examination. He says, never have I seen a witness destroying the cross-examiner in such a manner. Apparently, Mr. Palkiwala, while being cross-examined about the authenticity, originality of the book, was able to narrate entire 600 pages without even looking at a single slip of a paper. At the end of the deposition, things were very clear. Nobody could possibly think of copying the book, but considering the kind of the ability, each section was dissected by him. It was he could supplement each the section with the case law, etc. That was one instance to share. So what an amazing memory he had. The other aspect I was mentioning about his ability was his great oratorial skills, which of course most of you know, Mr. Palkhivala was supposed to one of the greatest. He was in fact compared to Aristotle. His ability to argue a case. It was said, and legend has it, that whenever Mr. Palkhivala argued in a court, he used to cast such a spell over the judges that most of the junior judges were warned by the senior judges never deliver a judgment after Palkhivala argues, because he would have cast a spell. Always retire back to your chambers, allow that spell to go away from you, then deliver the judgment. This was being said in a lighter vein, of course, to show, the way he used to lay down the facts and argue the matters, almost no judge could possibly disagree with him at that point of time. But his oratorial skills really reached the pinnacle in what we can call as a post-budget analysis he used to do. Now, for the uninitiated, I must slightly mention and bring to your notice that Mr. Palkhivala was also part of an organization called Freedom of Forum for Free Enterprises, which primarily championed the cause for free enterprises, capitalistic economy, etc. Now, in 1958, they started this practice of analyzing the budget. Every year, as the finance minister used to present the budget, in the evening, Mr. Palkhivala, in the next day, Palkhivala used to analyze that budget and give his own version of it. So in 1958, they started inviting Mr. Palkhivala to analyze the budget. The original budget analysis started in Hotel Greens. Whoever is familiar in Mumbai, they will know on Marine Drive, there is a small hotel called Greens. It was started from a very small hall. But from the day one, for the first year, that is 1958, he started analyzing the budget so brilliantly. The organizers realized that there is no place. We cannot accommodate people. It became so popular. Then they have to shift the venue to the very famous Brabourne Stadium in Cricket Club of India, which is very close to Marine Drive. Many of my viewers would be surprised to know that at any given point of time, when Mr. Palkhivala is to analyze the budget, there is to be a 1 lakh people in the entire stadium. With pin drop silence, Mr. Palkhivala was only interrupted by a round of applause. And for about 3 to 4 hours, without a single slip of a paper, he used to analyze the budget. Therefore, it came to be known that there used to be in India always 2 budgets presented, one by the finance minister of the day and another by Mr. Palkhivala. And it is also well known that most of the finance ministers, later on it became so popular, used to incorporate all the suggestions Mr. Palkhivala used to make, particularly Dr. Manmohan Singh, in the future budgets. In fact, I had personally had one opportunity to watch him when he had come down to Bangalore, and he used to deliver the post-budget analysis to go all over the country. Once at the Syndicate Hall in Vidhan Sautha, wherein I remember very vividly seeing when we went across, I was a student of law, that the hall was so jam-packed, there was no place to stand. Four, five hours he spoke without a single sit of paper, fiscal analysis, the capital expenditure, every aspect of Income Tax Act, the budget, how should the policy should be laid out, etc. We were all, it is something seen to be believed. Therefore, I remember reading, after someone who returned from the Brabourne Stadium one day wrote, never has a cricket stadium been so filled even without a single cricket ball being bowled. That was his ability of speaking to such a large audience with absolute clarity. This was Mr. Palkhivala's ability of public speaking, of course, not in the court halls. And as I was mentioning, his ability to speak in the court halls, of course, stand recorded in very two famous quotations, I will tell you. One was, of course, the very famous case of Keshavananda Bharati, which I will refer to slightly later. It is said that the argument which he advanced before the Honorable Supreme Court of India in Keshavananda Bharati Part 2, not the first one, when Chief Justice Ray had constituted a 13-judge bench to reconsider the principles of Keshavananda Bharati, on for 2 continuous days, Mr. Palkhivala addressed the court so brilliantly that the honorable judges who had come almost prepared to overrule Bharati, Chief Justice Ray, had to dissolve the bench prematurely and get up and go, thereby saving the citizenry and the country of the principles of Keshavananda Bharati, which I'll refer. Referring to his argument, Justice Khanna, who was one of the judges who presided over the Supreme Court, writes in his autobiography, Neither Roses Nor Thorns, that the height of eloquence which Mr. Palkiwala reached that day while arguing not to reconsider Keshavananda Bharati, never again will this august body of the Supreme Court surpass. Nobody can possibly surpass or reach the eloquence. It was not Palkiwala speaking, Nani speaking, but it was divinity speaking through Nani. That was his compliment. I remember hearing Mr. Rohinton, Justice Rohinton Nariman, he said, the greatest advocate argument by the greatest advocate ever to have been addressed before any court. Such was his ability in terms of oratorial skills. You could imagine what a gifted personality he was, as I said, but never to take it granted, extremely humble before the court, always listening to a query to be made by the judges, making it a point. There were instances where he possibly did not know an answer. He always said, I'm not aware of it. Let me get back to Lordships on that question. The anecdotes keep saying. This would sum up possibly Mr. Palkiwala's skills, ability of speaking, his ability to recall or retain anything. There are several anecdotes, time may not permit now. Therefore, let me now come to the second phase of what we would say of his contribution to the evolution of constitutional jurisprudence in this country. Now, in my opening remarks said, Mr. Palkiwala was known as the greatest defender of constitutional liberties in this country. And that stands testified by his great argument he advanced in Keshavananda Bharati's case. But before that, there are a couple of other cases which we must mention, in which Mr. Palkiwala made very significant contributions. Now, whoever has studied the constitutional jurisprudence of this country will know that the golden line of Article 31, where the constitution really evolved, was starting from Shankari Prasad, Sajjan Kumar, Golaknath, A.K. Gopalan, Keshavananda Bharati, Minerval Mintz, and of course thereafter. And you could see Indira Gandhi versus Raj Narayan in between. You could see in almost all the cases, Mr. Palkiwala appeared. Starting from Golaknath, he appeared in Golaknath, Keshavananda Bharati, and Minerva Mills. But two other cases I must mention, which his arguments really have found great significance and which have laid down as a great precedent value for other courts to follow consistently. The first case I would refer was what is known as the bank nationalization case. We are all aware the bank nationalization case was one of the important orders passed by the government led by Srimati Indira Gandhi in 1970s, by which 14 scheduled banks were nationalized, which included Syndicate Bank, Dena Bank, etc., by an executive order. And ironically, none of the banks called into question any of this this order. And it was one of the shareholders of Canara Bank, namely Rustam Kuwar G. Cooper, who challenged that before the Supreme Court, which very famously now we know as R.C. Cooper versus Union of India. The arguments were led by Mr. Palkiwala. He there called into question for the first time again, utilized this, argued this principle of legislative incompetence. He said that though the union government had the power to legislate on banking, but it had got exceeded in going ahead and legislating on the subject of property. He argued on Article 19. He argued on the right of the shareholders vis-a-vis that of the company to approach the court. Of course, one or two of his submissions were not accepted by the Supreme Court, but overall, on the principle that it was an arbitrary action, the court accepted the argument, and it continues to be an authority of property vis-a-vis Article 19 till today, and that it came to be known as the bank nationalization case. The second important case was of what is known as Privy Purses case. Now, this has a very interesting political background to this. We are all aware that at the time when India became independent, more than 561 princely states were there, which came to be integrated in the independent India, thanks mainly to the efforts made by the then Home Minister Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, wherein they signed instrument of accession, etc. Somewhere in 1969-70, Srimati Indira Gandhi decided that it was a matter of policy. They passed an amendment to the constitution. They sought to amend the constitution by abolishing privy purses and de-recognizing all these Raja Pramukhs and princes, rulers, etc. Unfortunately, they did not succeed before the parliament. Though the bill was passed in Lok Sabha for various reasons, before the Rajya Sabha it was defeated. Then what the government of the day did was, under Article 366, subclause 22, they passed an executive order. The then President Sri Giri, Mr. V.V. Giri was the president, they passed an executive order abolishing privy purses and bringing in, de-recognizing these Raja Pramukhs and rulers. And one of the, at that time, the Maharaja of Gwalior, the ruler of Gwalior, challenged that before the Supreme Court in what is known as Madhav Rao Jivaji Rao Sindhia vs. Union of India, which is also very famously known as abolition of privy purses, abolition of privy purses cases. In that case, Mr. Palkiwala, apart from other arguments, why I mentioned this is a very great significance is, evolved this concept of constitutional morality. He said, a law made by the parliament or the executive may meet the standards of the constitution, but should meet the higher standards of constitutional morality. He thereafter referred to the instrument of succession, the history of independent India, the concept of political sovereignty, the importance of a Solomon promise made by the government at that time when Union of India was formed to all these princes, that they will, if they are to accede to the Union of India, they would be paid X amount of privy purse and they would be recognized as Raja Pramukhs, princes, kings, etc. And after some time, even the government of the day cannot recoil from that Solomon promise. It would be constitutionally immoral. Therefore, he brought this argument, he lifted the argument to the principle of constitutional morality. Of course, as most of you would know, the principle of constitutional morality has now been followed by the Supreme Court in a number of cases, particularly the ones which their lordships have decided very recently. This argument of his, of course, he also argued on the principle of Article 123, which I'll refer later. And of course, the Honorable Supreme Court once again accepted almost all the principles laid down by him and struck down the abolition of privy purses, thereby restoring back the privileges or the privy purses to the Maharajas. Of course, history has it known that soon after that decision, it led to a political catastrophe, I would say, wherein Mrs. Gandhi prematurely dissolved the parliament, of course, came back with a romping majority of 358 and brought in then a constitutional amendment by which privy purses came to be abolished. That was a political formation. But these two principles, abolition of privy purses in which he argued about constitutional morality and R.C. Cooper's case where he argued on Article 19, remain in authority till this day. The third one judgment, which I must now refer and which most of you have by this time known, is what is known as Keshavananda Bharati versus Union of India. Now, which is also known as the fundamental rights case, most of you would know, and for the uninitiated, I must give a brief background and what actually happened in Keshavananda Bharati. Goloknath's case, as I was referring to, which was again argued by Palkiwala. The Supreme Court, led by that time, Chief Justice Subbarao, had held that the law under Article 13 would include constitutional law. Therefore, if the parliament is to make any law which would violate Part 3 of the constitution, the Supreme Court was, it was possible for the Supreme Court to hold that law as unconstitutional. Now, in order to overcome, and for several reasons, 24th and 25th Amendment to the Constitution, by which Article 368 itself was changed, which said that what is the it is open for the Parliament to amend the Constitution, including that under Part 3. This led to a very, very precarious situation. The question was, the main question was before the Supreme Court, whether the Parliament, in its paramount power, could amend the Constitution, which could take away or abridge any of the rights conferred under Part 3. Now, the word amend, as it appears under Article 368 in red grammatically, would say that yes, why not? If Parliament has the power to amend the Constitution, it has amend to do anything under Part 3. Therefore, what is the true and correct meaning of the word amend? Mr. Palkhivala at that time was assisted by Mr. Soli Sarabji, and I read Mr. Soli Sarabji writing later on after his demise that he used to assist him in at Hotel Oberoi in Mumbai while preparing for this case. Mr. Palkhivala had possibly summoned the written constitutions of almost all the world. There was only one problem. His juniors told him, "Sir, everything is fine, but in the history of the world, no court has struck down a constitutional amendment. What we are staring at a situation where we are seeking the Honorable Supreme Court to strike down an amendment made to the Constitution itself by the Parliament." Undeterred, of course, and that is why he is known as God's gift to India. That is a word coined by Sri Raj Gopalachari. That is why he said God's gift to India. Why I mentioned this name is, it is that point he brought out this principle of basic structure of the Constitution. He said, Parliament though has the power amend, but Parliament itself being the creator under the statute or under the Constitution cannot go beyond the Constitution itself. The Constitution or the Constituent Assembly have given certain basic features to the Republic, that we shall be a republic, we shall be a democratic, we shall not be a monarchy. We shall have a universal adult franchise, we shall have periodic elections, we'll have an independence of judiciary, etc. These are all features, these are all fundamental principles embodied in the Constitution, which form the basic structure. And they can never be taken away, even by a majoritarian government, even by an absolute majority of the Parliament, because Parliament itself is a creature of the Constitution. Under the Constitution. This theory, what is known as basic structure, fundamental theory, was evolved by him, argued before the Honorable Supreme Court, in which there were 13 judges, and finally accepted by the Supreme Court, where the Supreme Court held once for all that till here afterwards, even a parliament with an absolute majority cannot amend the Constitution, which would take away the basic structure itself, basic features of the Constitution. Of course, the judgment, as most of you would know, was vertically divided. There were 6 judges who held that the Parliament has the power to amend. 6 judges held Parliament does not have the power to amend. And the tilting vote or tilting judgment was that of Justice Khanna, who said that Parliament has no power to amendment. Therefore, by majority, it became the law of the land. And as I was mentioning, there was an attempt made after about 2 years to review that order by Justice Ray, who constituted a bench to review that. That was not possible. The bench came to be dissolved, and he's supposed to have argued one of the most brilliant arguments ever advanced in the Supreme Court. Therefore, we have seen his contribution in bank nationalization, Privy versus Keshavananda Bharati. The last of the judgments I must mention, which he made a very significant contribution, was in what is known as the Minerva Mills case, which again concerned the 42nd Amendment. Yet another attempt was made by way of 42nd Amendment. almost revisiting the Keshavananda Bharati principles. That was again challenged by him. There was an amendment to Article 31C, or amendment to Article 368. In that, he said, he argued on Article 123. He argued the delicate balance between fundamental rights and the directive principles of state policy. One of the most brilliant theories he evolved in Minerva Mill's case was, when he said, however noble your objective is, the state's objective, however evolved your theory is, whatever nobility you want to achieve through directive principles of state policy, but if you do so by violating fundamental rights, it will set at naught. So any welfare state, if you want to achieve a welfare object, should always be in compliance with Part 3 of the Constitution. And therefore, he said, fundamental principles of directive state principles of state policy and fundamental rights must be always read in harmony. They supplement each other, which of course was again accepted by the Supreme Court, Justice Bhagavati, the leading judgment. And that completes the series of judgments wherein he contributed in a very evolved manner his contribution to constitutional jurisprudence. Of course, when you analyze the graph of Mr. Palkewala's arguments in various cases, you have Chunilal versus State of Mumbai, where he argued under Section 100 of the Civil Procedure Code as to what is a substantial question of law. And for all our lawyers who have practiced in civil society, whenever we used to see his RSA, I still remember my father telling me, what is a substantial question of the only judgment you have to read is Chunilal versus State of Mumbai. And when we open it, it is Palkewala's again argument, wherein he evolved this theory of what is a substantial question of law. Ujjambai, the last of the cases he argued was, of course, was in the case of Indira Sahni versus Union of India, which is, of course, very famously known as the Mandal Commission judgment, wherein he said the caste will divide this country. And it is only economic criteria. For some reasons, it was never accepted. But I remember that was the last of the judgments he has argued before the Supreme Court. There are many more cases he has argued, but I thought I must pick up three or four of them for the benefit of all of you. Now, if this was the contribution made by Mr. Palkewala in the evolution of the constitutional jurisprudence, it is quite natural for my younger friends to ask, then why didn't Mr. Palkewala become a judge? Why didn't he become an advocate general? Why didn't he become an attorney general? He was such a brilliant man. Now, what I'm going to tell you, you may not believe, but it is a fact. At the age of 43, Mr. Palkewala was asked to become a Supreme Court judge directly. If he had become a judge of the Supreme Court at the age of 43, he would have had an unparalleled history of being the Chief Justice of India for 15 long years, which he refused. At the age of 45, the then Prime Minister, Srimati Indira Gandhi, offered him to become the Law Minister. He refused. At the age of 48, he was asked to become the Attorney General of India. He accepted, only to refuse the next day. In his one of his notes, he says why he did not accept any of these offices. He says the shackles of office possibly would have never allowed me to represent this great citizenry of my country against an arbitrary and authoritative government. I mean, you could imagine the man, 43, 47, 48, only two things he accepted. At the age of 35, he was persuaded by Jawaharlal Nehru to become the member of the first law commission, and also after his term, member of the second law commission. The other only official post he accepted was when Sri Morarji Desai was the Prime Minister of India. He sent the External Affairs Minister, then Atal Bihari Vajpayee, to Mumbai to convince Mr. Palkewala that he will accept and become the ambassador of India to United States. As usual, Mr. Palkewala refused, and Mr. Vajpayee then said to have told that he would stand in dharna unless he accepted it, which he finally acceded and accepted. That was the only post he accepted, and of course he made his mark even in United States by addressing the vast senators in the United States. That's how his life graph has been. And very interestingly, when he has refused all these things, Mr. Vajpayee therefore said once, Mr. Palkhivala was one of the greatest law minister which India never had. And looking at his economic forensic skills, his ability of budgetary skills, Dr. P.C. Alexander, who was an advisor to the Prime Minister Srimati Indira Gandhi, said, Mr. Palkhivala is the greatest finance minister which India never had. The former Chief Justice of India, Mr. Lodha, Justice Lodha, says, Mr. Palkhivala was one of the finest judges which the Supreme Court never had. And Rajaji, as I was mentioning to you, all of you, said, he was God's gift to India. If these were the accolades, if these were the aspects, what made him so special? What made him worthy of emulation for all of us was not just his exemplary character in terms of what his achievements were, but he was more than anything else, a great human being. All of you would be, it would be of some interest for most of you to know, considering his practice, most lucrative practice. He was director of several Tata companies, etc. Possibly represented almost every corporate company possible. But at the end of his career and life, he practically gave away all his earnings to Shankara Foundation. Even in his height of practice, he used to contribute 10% of his this one to Bharati Vidya Bhavan. And all his earnings, he gave it away to Shankara Foundation, thereby once again sending a message that charity is more than all this. In fact, in his book, We the People, he very famously quotes a poem, which I really think is very apt and necessary for all of you to know. He says, the law the lawyers know about is of property and land. But why the leaves are on the trees? Why the waves disturb the seas? Why winter comes when rivers freeze? Why horses have such tender knees? Why faith is more than what one sees? And why charity is more than all these? The lawyers will never understand. And the last word when he says, why charity is more than all these, he actually lived up to it and gave up everything possible. Apart from this, he was possibly a great human being, a great friend, a great mentor to juniors. Today's most of the legal luminaries have grown under him. Let be Mr. Harish Salve, Soli Sarabji, Mr. Iqbal Chagla, who was a doyen of Mumbai Bar. Most of them have under the tutelage of Mr. Palkhivala. And Mr. Palkhivala remains and will continue to remain as possibly one of the greatest icon, I will say, an icon and an inspiration always for almost all of us. Now, before as we come, Trivikram, do we have some time? What is that? I must mention.
Yes, sir, certainly we have. I'm sorry, I was muted. Yeah. Yes, sir, we have sufficient time.
Yeah. So there were two other contributions, representations he made for the country, which I must mention before we conclude. Because that was a very, very important contribution Mr. Palkhivala made to the country. At the height when he was arguing these cases against the government, you could imagine. I mean, you have a hostile, you are arguing against the government, let it be privy purses cases or our bank nationalization. You're taken on the government directly. But the government, looking at his skills, engaged him directly to argue on behalf of the country in the run of Kutch case in the tribunal in Geneva. So it would be of some interest for you to know that there was a very serious border dispute between India and Pakistan, for which, in fact, both of them went to war in 1965 over the western boundary of India, that's Gujarat, which is also known as the Run of Kutch, when Pakistan claimed that 3,500 square miles belonged to it and that there was that India had occupied. This led to President Wilson convincing both India and Pakistan to agree for constitution of a tribunal of resolution of this dispute, which both the countries agreed. And Srimati Gandhi then chose Mr. Palkhivala to represent the country. And at that time, he conducted this litigation on behalf of the country for 2 years in Geneva in the special tribunal. And is said to have referred to more than 350 cartographic maps. And he argued on the concepts of how the run of the Rao of Kutch, who had lost possession temporarily, had not lost sovereignty, which led to the tribunal finally holding that there was no encroachment. Thereby, not only did he subserve the interests of the citizenry, but also the interests of the country by winning very successfully and representing the country in the run of Kutch case. The second international case in which he represented the country was about the airspace between India and Pakistan. As we all know, prior to creation of Bangladesh, East Pakistan, India had prevented Pakistan from flying across its airspace, which led to Pakistan again raising a dispute before the World Court. There again, he represented the country very successfully. These were very two important contributions I thought I must mention about he representing the country. He also had the courage and conviction of what he believed in. He always believed that the greatest disservice which a citizen can make is to be intellectually dishonest, and should always lead by keeping a constant vigil on encroachment of fundamental rights. But as I conclude, I must say, the first poem I have narrated, there were two other poems which were very, very close to his heart. One was, of course, the very famous poem of Rudyard Kipling, If, in which it was most befitting to Mr. Palkhivala's life, wherein Kipling says, if you can keep your head high when all others are losing theirs, if you can walk with the kings and not lose the common touch, be with the crowd, yet not lose the virtue. If you can win both, if you can treat both victory and defeat, these two imposters just the same. If you can give the unforgiving minute 60 seconds worth of distance run, it is the world will be yours and you'll be a man. This apparently was very close to Mr. Palkhivala's heart. He always kept it with him. And the other poem which I felt was relevant for the COVID times we had was This Too Shall Pass. To all my young friends who are a little disheartened in these gloomy days, don't ever be. Let us remember Palkhivala. These are all people who led their life with exemplary character, honesty. And when he says, this too shall pass, it shall pass. I want to conclude by quoting Justice Benjamin Cardozo, when he writes in this book, The Judicial Process, when he says, the future belongs to you, gentlemen. In this ageless process, we have been asked to do our bit. But as long after I'm dead and gone, and we have finished our bit, the torch shall continue to flame brightly, so long as it is in your hands. All of you, particularly my younger friends, Mr. Ranganath keeps telling me they are in difficulty. Please don't lose heart. Please don't lose your will. Things are going to be better. Think better days are going to come. You all are the future, who have to keep the flag flying high. Bangalore Bar has the greatest tradition. Bangalore Bar has produced some of the exemplary lawyers and judges. You are all the leaders of the future, and wishing you all the very best. And once again, thanking Mr. Ranganath and his team and the members of the Advocate Association for giving me an opportunity to share my thoughts. I will be ready. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir, for your inspiring words and for facilitating us to visualize the life and times of the courtroom genius. In the usual course, we used to have the Q&A session, the question and answer session. Apparently, if you could permit us today, we can have interactive session for a few minutes, because all our viewers would be very eager to interact with you.
Surely, surely.
Yes. Mr. Akash, request you to unmute all the viewers.
Your panelists can unmute themselves.
Yes. Whosoever wants to interact with our senior, you can unmute and you can go ahead with the conversation.
Hello. Hello, Mr. Navadgi. How are you?
Fine, sir. Thank you.
Wonderful, sir. Mr. Navadgi, I had an opportunity to appear before your father in the district court when he was a judge in the year 1972. In fact, I went to his chambers to invite him for my marriage. Within 2 days, I received a greetings letter from him. A very good judge. And he was giving a very patient hearing to each and every advocate, particularly the younger members of the bar.
Thank you, sir. Wonderful sharing, sir.
Prabhuling.
Hello, Harish.
Prabhuling. How are you? Congratulations. Excellent articulation and excellent tribute to Nani Palkhivala. I also used to attend all his post-budget analysis lecture series in Bangalore at Banquet Hall, Vidhan Sabha.
Banquet Hall, correct.
Right. Every year it used to happen, the very next day he used to land here for an address to Fiki and also at Banquet Hall, Vidhan Sabha. I used to be there. I in fact picked up this book when I attended this one of his things, the lectures in Vidhan Sabha. We the nation and we the people, all these books were being sold at that thing. To put it in a nutshell, knowing the generosity and charity done by Palkhivala, I can only say he was an embodiment of charity in humility and humility in charity.
Absolutely. I agree.
That's the best way to put it. And people, I think the younger generation should read the Courtroom Genius book. Written by Palkhivala.
There is one more book which is very rare. I'll just show it to you.
Yeah.
It's Nani Palkhivala, God's Gift to India.
This is by Bhandari. By Bhandari.
All of you should make it as a collection. Very nice.
I was about to mention this. Luckily, you showed me. It was written by Bhandari. It's an excellent book. It's worth it. In fact, Palkhivala at a very young age wrote a book on income tax. He was the youngest author of income tax in those days of his. He was very popularly known, and his book on We the People, Largest Democracy, is also worth reading, from which you quoted the poem. I think it's an excellent nice to see you as the Advocate General. Congratulations, all the best. Wish you all success in all your endeavors entered each day in your life.
Thank you.
Sir, do we have anyone else who would like to interact with the senior?
Vikram.
Yes, sir. Murthy, sir.
Yeah, hello, sir. Good evening.
Murthy, how are you?
Sir, it's widely known that after Mrs. Gandhi imposed the emergency, Mr. Palkhivala returned her brief in the Supreme Court, which arose out of the Election Commission, as a mark of protest.
Correct.
So, do you think such principles are difficult to be adopted or followed in today's time in public life?
That's why I said, if you can be in the crowd and still keep the virtue. he had that ability, where in fact he represented soon after Allahabad judgment. He was able to successfully grant an interim order from Justice Krishna Iyer, The day emergency was imposed, he wrote a letter back to her. I deeply respect you personally, but I cannot digest the fact what has been done, and therefore written. That is the correct courage and the conviction which a man has had, and this one. And for the Mr. Ranganath's information, I want him to know, he always was also a champion of the bar. When Mr. Ram Jaikumalani was arrested in Mumbai, he rallied all the lawyers, Advocates Association of Lawyers, 400 lawyers together. He marched towards the court and filed wakalat for release of Mr. Jaikumalani. Therefore, he was also a great champion of advocates' cause.
And thank you.
Thank you, sir. Do we have anyone else?
Sir, good evening. Suresh here. I must congratulate you for having given so much information about Nani Palkhivalaji. It was really wonderful. Sir, my question to you is, sir, this country has seen many legal luminaries. So if you can recall few of them, sir, who would it be, sir?
Ms. Palkhivala is one of them. We had so many lawyers, Motilal Settlewar, Daftari, Ms. Nambiar, Justice Krishna Iyer, Justice Chagla, Justice H.R. Khanna. I mean, the list goes on. You must read some of the books. of these legends.
Fine. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. I think that's about it. So we are much indebted to you, sir. Thanks for giving us your valuable time. We know your tight schedule. In between that, you have tried to accommodate us. And thanks for the extraordinary presentation. Thank you once again.
It's a pleasure. And I must thank the Advocates Association once again for giving me an opportunity. Kindly convey my regards to your president and all of his parents.
Thank you. Thank you so much. With your permission, we'll be logging off the
sessions. Thank you.